I want to stay on this topic a little bit here, because part of it is the money. Nobody wants to lose the money of the taxpayers like that. The larger part of it is, what is it doing to our operation in Afghanistan in terms of this counterinsurgency angle that we've taken over there? And one aspect of that, as I understand it from General Petraeus' own writings, is that, you know, corruption and feeding into corruption is not going to be helpful, is one of the main things that has to not happen in order for the counterinsurgency to be effective. So the publicly available legal documents that were filed by Watan in the case, they had it said, said this. Watan argued that the alleged bribes were not bribes per se, but rather facilitation payments. They argued that Watan had no choice but to pay Afghan government officials and other armed groups for police protection, while Watan transported cargo for the United States military through Afghan's volatile war zone. General Towson, do you agree that the security operators or contractors had no choice but to make those payments?
I do agree that in many cases they don't have a choice, and they perceive that they don't have a choice. They perceive that they'll be attacked if they don't make some of these payments.
And Mr. Motzik, do you agree with Watan's analysis that these so-called facilitation payments, or bribes, as some of us might say, large sums of cash provided to provincial governors, to local police, or warlords, in order to ensure that the trucks aren't bothered, do you think that that's legal under United States law?
Clearly it's not. It is clearly, and it's counterproductive to what we're trying to do. And, again, it's part of the larger systemic problem that we have.
So here's what Watan's court filing goes on to state. The Army allowed and encouraged HNT contractors to do and pay whatever was necessary to ensure convoy security and prevent loss of life. The Army engaged in the affirmative misconduct by encouraging private contractors to undertake activities that the Army only disavowed once they were exposed to the public. Mr. Denver, was the Army aware of the apparently common practice of facilitation payments, and does it encourage people like Watan to make them?
I'm not familiar with whether the Army had that information. I would tell you this, in conversations that when I had a meeting with the suspension debarment official, I think he indicated the same that you've heard today, that the facilitation payments were necessary. So in that context, I would say, when Watan came to the table and identified what they paid, in that context, I would say that's when it became we were aware. But I'm not familiar with as to whether we were aware prior to, sir.
Another court filing, Watan stated that the Army apparently made a policy determination that having its contractors pay for safe passage and money is cheaper than paying for that same passage in guns, bullets, and bodies. The court filing goes on to call extortion payments the realities of Afghan society and the realities of this war. Do you agree, General Towson? It's simply, it's just a cost of fighting war in Afghanistan.
I'm not sure I'd agree that it's the cost of fighting war in Afghanistan. It's certainly part of the landscape in Afghanistan. And we took extraordinary efforts down even at the very low tactical level every day to try to root out, when we would hear a report that a checkpoint was charging a passage fee, a toll, we would go investigate that and go to great lengths to try to find out if they were charging a toll and how ways we could mitigate that. There, for one example, is we actually posted billboards beside some of these checkpoints that said you don't have, there's no toll required to pass to this checkpoint. Then you have to deal with the Afghan literacy rate below 30%, and you
and the
have
fact to, that somebody with a gun is standing there asking for a toll.
Some guy with a gun is standing there. You know, there's no argument from us that the corruption is probably the biggest victims, I think, are the Afghan people, even more so than the American taxpayer.
So the International Crisis Group wrote, I think, saliently, there's a nexus between criminal enterprises, insurgent networks, and corrupt political practices in Afghanistan. We know that there are a pile of relatives of people in high political offices that are involved in these contracts or subcontractors and making these payments or whatever. So my question is, in order to break that nexus, what prosecutions have happened? How many people have been prosecuted? How high up the chain? The Afghan people, can they see an example of some of these well-connected people actually being brought to the rule of law? Or are they going to continue to be an impediment to our insurgency, counterinsurgency, because they think the whole game's rigged and the government's as bad as the Taliban?
I can answer that question not in the context of what we're talking about here, trucking, you know, corruption. Right. But
that's just indicative. Well, that's just indicative of a much larger picture, so I'm happy to have you broaden it out.
Kabul Bank, for example. There are a number of officials that are under investigation with respect to the Kabul Bank situation, corruption practice there, incident there. And I think that we're hopeful that the Afghan government will prosecute some of those parties, but it's yet to happen. But there are a number of investigations, over 20 investigations in work with Kabul Bank, and we're waiting to see what they do. And we're right now, the United States government is conditioning some of our support to see the outcome of Kabul Bank.
Well, I would hope so. I mean, you just drive from the airport where you land your plane down to the Capitol and look up, and you can see houses up there that are well-heeled people living in that, and the regular Afghan people just really suffering and having a hard time making it, and they get it too on that. I don't know how you ever get the confidence of them to support having this country come around and move in the right direction without doing more in that regard. So I think you've got your work cut out for you. I think we ought to take a real hard look at our mission over there and the prospects for accomplishing our well-intended goals on this thing without really addressing that issue the way it ought to be. And I know it's political, and I know there are people like the intercession. I understand there are people into the Watan case and the Rahotula case with the Papal brothers or whatever. That's a good example of why people would be disgusted when somebody should have been debarred and should have been out there, that all of a sudden they get a slap on the wrist and are off and running. This is not good. Not good, and I think we have to be cautious of that. I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chair.